Our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. Sounds comforting, and it also sounds very sovereign. He does anything that he wants and wills to do. God does whatever he pleases, and whatever pleases him, he does. This is scripture. Psalms 115, verse 3. Psalms 135, verse 6. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does. In heaven and on earth, in the seas and all depths. Now that's very comforting to hear. So if God is pleased that every person is saved, every person comes to repentance, and he is pleased at that, then he will do it. We have to turn to 2 Timothy 3:9. 2 Timothy or is it 2 Peter? 2 Timothy. Let's look at this. Oh no, it's 2 Peter 3:9. And it says, this is the English Standard Version. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you. That's a plural you, specific people he's speaking to. Not wishing or willing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. That is what pleases God, that all should reach repentance, and that he's not willing that any should perish. Any of whom? Because we know people are going to hell and some are going to heaven. We know some will not believe, some will. And Christ himself said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. All men. And then he says, if any man comes to me, in no wise will I cast out. Wow, Derek, you're building a case for universal atonement, universal redemption. You're building a case that everyone's going to be saved then. Or everyone of certain people. Because if we take this modern evangelical stance that God is wanting every person to be saved, then guess what? He failed. And he fails time and time again at saving people. Because the Old Testament makes it clear, he does whatever he pleases. Did our God change? Is he not the same yesterday, today, and forever? If it would please the Lord that every single person is saved, then that's what will happen. But I strongly recommend we look at the beginning of 2 Peter. 2 Peter 1:1, the beginning of this book. Who is he writing to? Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So he is writing to believers, people who are saved. This is the elect, the chosen people of God. Those are who he's writing to. And he's talking about something we learn in covenant theology here in 2 Peter 3:9. But you can really dig into this. But he is not slack or slow concerning or to fulfill his promise. As some count slowness. His promise is to his people alone. Not to every person. And his promise of eternal life. That none will perish. That all come to repentance. And if that isn't enough to, you know, encourage you, because he's specifically talking to the group when he says toward us in the King James as it's rendered, or toward you as a plural you in the Greek, then we need to turn to Matthew 18, verse 10. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. This is the parable of the lost sheep. For I tell you that in heaven, T-H-E-I-R, there, angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Well, there is talking about specific people. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountain and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Wow. He's talking about sheep. The elect that have gone astray. He's saying it's not his will that any of these little ones should perish. I strongly agree that none of those little ones will perish unless we believe God failed or fails. This is why we have people who believe in universal redemption and universal atonement, that every person's going to go to heaven. Who cares? You don't really even have to believe, because at least they do recognize something, that the atonement of Christ, now I gotta say, it's heretical, but they recognize something. The atonement of Christ was an atonement that paid for sins. They take it as it actually paid for every person's sins. And logically consistent in their theology, they conclude every person is going to be saved off of passages like this without recognizing the specific, the limited to these people. This atonement was for his people. He came to bear the sins of his people. Matthew 1:22, I believe it is. He actually died for his people's sins. Everyone is not his people. Now, if God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he has a chosen people in the Old Testament, why wouldn't he have a chosen people even today from every nation, tribe, and tongue? Revelation 13:8 says that those who actually bow down and worship the beast were those whose names were not written in the Lamb's Book of Life that was slain before the foundation of the world. Huh? Pretty wild, because they worship the beast. Why? Because their names were not written in the book. We want to get that backwards. We want to say, well, because they worshiped the beast, then their names weren't written in the Lamb's Book of Life that was written before the foundation of the world? That makes no sense. Logically, their names were not written in that Lamb's Book of Life before the foundation of the world. That is why they worshiped the beast in Revelation 13:8 and 17:8. So we like to get stuff backwards. We don't like to look at Acts 13:48, as many as were ordained to eternal life, those are the ones that believed. We like to go, those that believed were ordained for eternal life. But it doesn't say that. I strongly urge and suggest you, brothers, that the reason why we don't have it like a book set out aside from Paul or the, you know, in the epistles going, let me tell you, let's debate this issue of predestination, of God choosing whom he would choose before the foundation of the world, because it was commonly understood in these days. There was no battle or fight over this. And there is hint and mention through all of the New Testament and Old Testament of this doctrine of election and doctrine of predestination before the foundation of the world, all on God and God doing what he pleases and him doing what he wills. This doctrine has it's embedded and weaved throughout the whole Bible. Why do we not have a book written about it? It wasn't debated. People like the Gnostics, well, Christ wasn't fully, or not just the Gnostics, but that he wasn't man, or he wasn't God, or, you know, changing the gospel to legalism and following Old Testament, you have to be circumcised to be saved as a Jew, etc., etc. Those are things that he debated and had issues with. But rather, it was commonly understood when Paul comes out in Ephesians 1, blessed be God who gives us the blessings, the spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. And even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless. Now why he chooses us then for? So that we would be holy and blameless. Can we thwart that purpose he had for us? We can't thwart God's purpose. No one can thwart him. Job 42:2. No one can thwart his purpose. Well, if his purpose is to choose some for holiness and to be blameless before the foundation of the world in love, having predestined us for adoption as sons, and you look over and over again throughout the New Testament, you get amazed. You get amazed to see how many people, in neglecting what the scriptures are saying, continue to say, no, he died for every single person's sins. 1 John 2:2, he's the propitiation for our sins, but not only ours, but for the whole world. John also writes that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Well, what do you mean by world? Because John also writes that if you love the world, the Father's love is not in you. There are also mentionings of John in John chapter 17 where Jesus said, I do not pray for the world, but those that you have given me out of the world. Hold on. What's world mean? Something's up here. Something's going on here that we're not catching on to. And we need to keep looking and keep studying. I strongly urge you, brothers and sisters, study and show thyself approved. And realize what the scriptures are saying. God bless you, and have a wonderful, wonderful day.